Salon Culture, Culture Action Europe Podcast.
Hello and welcome to the Culture Action Europe Elections Podcast Series. With the European Parliament elections coming up between the 23rd and 26th of May, Culture Action Europe is in the European Parliament to discuss key cultural topics with representatives of the major European political party groupings. We want to find out where MEPs stand on such critical cultural issues as freedom of artistic expression, mobility for cultural workers, and the place for culture in the digital age. In this episode, I am talking to Helga Trupel from the Green Party.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us, Ms. Trupel. So, to begin with, we're in a time when common European values and European unity, it seems that they've been taken for granted. And now we're increasingly seeing challenges to them. So I wonder, could you tell us, how do you see the role of culture in enhancing a positive understanding of Europe?
For me, democratic culture, not culture that is feeling superior to others, because that we had in European history as well. So that means my concept of democratic culture and culture with its intrinsic values is absolutely necessary so that Europeans can understand each other, can understand themselves, where they come from, what are their concerns, what are their belongings, what is important for them in life, because we find all that in literature, in music, in films, in photographies, general in the arts. And therefore I think culture, even if it's mostly a competence of the different nation states within the European Union, we have common programs like Creative Europe and other common programs that people can travel, see the cultural richness of Europe, can read and enjoy the different arts in their home countries and of all the other European countries. Of course, we nowadays have the possibilities to enjoy global art as well. But we are here for the competences of the European Union, and their culture is really essential, and it should not be only essential on Sunday speeches, but every day of the week.
Wonderful. And it's interesting that you talk about cultural richness there, because we're also seeing backlashes to cultural diversity. How can the EU actively support cultural diversity in both an online and offline context?
So to support and enhance cultural diversity is one of the goals of European cultural policies. It's even written in the treaties. And I think what we realize now, maybe differently in the member states, but more or less for decades now, that we are an immigration continent, that we have migrants and refugees, and that we have people, European people, going around living and working in different member states. And therefore, cultural richness, it is at the core of the, or is the basis of the whole way we live together. We cannot make the European Union and a peaceful life in the European Union without cultural diversity. And I think at the heart of a peaceful living is the conviction and commitment that we all have to deal in a good way with diversity. And if we are not ready to that, then we have a lot of problems, crime and being awful to other people. But I really think in the global situation we are living in the 21st century, all we have to learn and to do is to deal with diversity. And that always means cultural diversity, religious diversity, diversity of perspectives, and to find good ways to solve problems.
Yeah. And diversity of perspectives is, of course, something that the arts and culture are excellent at demonstrating. And still, we are seeing, again, both on and offline, increasing challenges to freedom of artistic expression. Would you support a European regulation to ensure freedom of artistic expression?
Yeah, of course. So on the other hand, I think we already have it in our treaties and the fundamental rights. And the Charter we have subscribed, they are very clear about the freedom of artistic expression. But in the given political circumstances, with situations in Hungary, Italy, Poland, where the government influence on the way how we remember what is played at the theaters, obviously it's urgent to repeat why we Europeans are so much in favor of artistic freedom.
Absolutely. And another problem for cultural workers today is adequate labor conditions. Yeah. This is exacerbated, of course, by platform work, which is something that is also affecting society more broadly. What role should the EU play in facilitating better labor conditions for artists and cultural workers?
Very generally, I think that we have to go for good market regulation of no digital monopolies. For example, from my point of view, the copyright reform is one of the cornerstones to make artists paid on the digital platforms, by the digital platforms. That is the whole debate on Article 13 about, and the Articles 14 to 16 of the copyright reform, so that there is a fair, appropriate remuneration of artists for all what users consume on the internet, if it's copyright protected and if they want to be paid. Normally, most of the artists want to be paid and not give it away for free. If they want to do it, of course, they have the freedom to do it. But normally, and that is what we really have to achieve with the platform capitalism now, and it's not only in the field of culture, the same with Uber and other services. We have to make sure if there is this modernization and digital revolution, and there are very good reasons for that, and we all enjoy it to a certain extent, but labor rights, fair payment, social rights must be maintained even in digital capitalism, not only in analog capitalism.
Yeah, and so another issue that affects the character of the careers of artists and cultural workers is that they tend to move around a lot as part of their work, which of course promotes access to culture for citizens and also promotes cultural diversity. But there are still many barriers to this, particularly for those who are coming in from outside the EU. So do you think that the EU should have an initiative to facilitate Schengen visas, for example, for artists and cultural workers?
Yes, on the CULT committee, we already had that position and we already had a lot of amendments in the reports to facilitate the access for artists with Schengen visa. Yes, that is our common position, but so far there is no majority in the council on that.
And then looking at the current situation with the rise of digital technology and increasing globalization, it seems to us that human soft skills are becoming more and more important. Mm-hmm. What's your position on reinforcing a shared cross-sectoral strategy for education and culture at EU level?
Okay, I myself come from Germany, and you know we have even the competences for culture and education on the Länder level, on the federal states level, because of the Nazi regime, not to have it top down, and because it was so much misused by Nazis. Generally, I think that the European Union must do more for education, culture, youth exchange, solidarity work for youngsters, all that, and we have to budget up. That's very crucial. Of course, we want at least the doubling of the culture program and for Erasmus, the education program. But generally, I think if you want to have more solidarity and a better sense of belonging to the European Union, especially in this field of culture and education, we have to do more.
Well, in fact, you have anticipated my final question there, which was about where you would stand on the doubling of the budget for culture. Then I think that I'm going to have to say thank you very much for participating in this podcast. I'm very pleased to hear that you do support the doubling of the budget for culture.
We even wanted to have more screens. But anyway, it will be very difficult to get it, because now the whole negotiations on the MFF are stuck, and you don't know what is going to happen. It will be terrible, I think.
In the next parliament, are you concerned that
Yeah, I'm very much concerned that the majorities are even more on the populists and more or less anti-Europeans, and in council we have a very difficult situation. And the current budget commissioner, Oeschninger, wanted to budget up, at least to a certain extent. And so far there is no real willingness in the council to do that. And of course, our interests with culture and education are totally linked to the outcome on the MFF negotiations. So we have to campaign and we have to make sure why it's so important. But on the other hand, we have to see what is going on in council, and we all, regardless where we live, we have to put pressure on our national governments, because they have the finance ministers who in the very end are with the parliament together important for the final outcome. And they have to move.
Absolutely. So everybody has heard that now. You know what you have to do. Petition your finance yes. ministers. You yes. can find a letter for this on the Culture Action Europe website to help you to do so. And thank you very much, Helga Trupel, for joining us for this podcast.
Thank you.
To take part in the Culture Action Europe election campaign and call for the future we want to see for culture and for Europe, just follow the link in the episode notes of this podcast. You can also join in the discussion in Culture Action Europe's live online dialogue, which will welcome MEPs and citizens to discuss a variety of themes, such as those we've been talking about today. This dialogue takes place on the 25th of April at jamart.eu, and you can find more information in the episode notes of this podcast. Thank you for listening, and don't forget to check out other episodes in this series and share it with your friends and colleagues.